Hi there, this is Dave with NDW K9, and what you're watching here is one of Deisels' first lessons. I want to say maybe it's the second or third time ever I began doing a loose leash walk with him. I was just working on motivational drive, giving him his own choices, letting him walk 45 feet in front of me, and then working on basic obedience within the house with a strong drive for food and toys, play drive. I realized the public, he is a foster dog through Heidi's Legacy Dog Rescue out here in Tampa, Florida. But I realized the public doesn't necessarily see a trained dog at 45 feet, nor would they want it in their home. So I began doing this loose leash walk with an automatic sit. And as you notice, I keep going back, I keep turning around. I did some editing this morning where you can't see the time frame, but this was a 32-minute video. And every time I turn around like this and I head back towards the home, I go in and I do some more door work, which I pretty much go back to point A. I start from point A, he becomes distracted, he starts smelling on the ground, starts looking away, doing that. I turn back around, go back inside, make him sit at the door, make him sit on the front porch, and then continue our walk. A lot of people think they're just going to throw the leash on the dog and head for a wonderful walk. Nice, polite, loose leash. It's not the case. It does take some work, but I have to say, after maybe doing it for a week, we were able to go into PetSmart under heavy distractions, and he did fairly well. He didn't do bad at all. Matter of fact, he did great. I was very surprised and very proud of him. It doesn't take much. As you notice, there is no prong collar. There isn't a choke chain. There isn't a shock collar on him for this exercise. Matter of fact, I'm not even really giving him a correction or how some trainers say applying any pressure to him. I'm just doing 180s, and if he doesn't do it correctly, we go back to point A. Now, the dogs are going to want to go outside and explore the world and have fun and go for a walk and get some exercise. So it's not that hard if you really don't leave the front walkway of your home for the first 3 or 4 days, and then after that, if you don't leave more than 100 to 200 feet in front of your home, they'll start getting the clue that if they don't walk by your side, that they don't get to go anywhere really besides in the front, which sucks. It sucks for you, it sucks for me, and it really sucks for them. But the point is, if you do want this controlled loose leash walk, it's going to take that initial effort to be bored out of your freaking skull, consistency, and going back to your front door and making him sit until he's calm, then you give an okay, and then you leave with your left foot. Some trainers refer to this as a heel. I don't. This is a controlled, constant, loose leash walk. You're making it a habit where they constantly remain by your side, no ifs, ands, or buts. A lot of people would get it a lot quicker. It wouldn't take 5 to 7 days for it to happened because, as you just saw him sniffing the grass right there, they give a quick leash correction. I'm not into killing the dog's spirit or drive. I want to keep the personality as much as possible, even if we are doing a controlled loose leash. So to keep as much of the dog's personality without killing the spirit and making it a freaking robot, and when you look in the eyes, as you see, his tail is up right here. He's pushing me. He's driving me for a heel. He wants a heel. In which I'm rewarding the heel and saying heel, good heel, good heel, because like I said, heel is different from his leash. Heel is eye contact. He's going to get a little distracted here with the neighbors coming up, but that's fine. Like I said, with your compulsion, course-based trainers using positive punishment, with the neighbors coming up and being distracted like this, they'd give a nice leash correction. But his tail would no longer be in the upright position, and his eyes would be in the oh shit position damn near all the time, and instead of having a happy, responsive dog, I'd have a scared dog who flinches to the voice commands. So that's not what we're looking for here. I have done some place work with the dog using a shock collar. It's unfortunate that I had to resort to this, but like I said, they are a foster dog. In America, you guys seem to want a dog to place and not move from the place at all times, and to walk on a loose leash. Hopefully, with my help and getting my house dwindled down of dogs, huge impact on the way society teaches their dogs. I'm really hoping for that. It's beautiful right there, nice automatic sit. Like I said, no compulsion. I didn't give a leash correction at all. Just 180s, treating, praising, just using what the dogs naturally have to learn, you know, using their instincts. They love to eat. So give them a highly valuable reward, you know, make sure their stomachs aren't full. They just didn't eat breakfast or dinner before you went out. It should be easy. Their treats are cut up small enough where they don't get full too quick. Be able to work a dog for a while. Now with this, I was working the dog for about 30 minutes, which usually in training, that exceeds limitations, and the dogs start to not learn as well. You know, it's not about breaking them down mentally, it's about teaching them. When you do an hour's worth of training, it's not necessarily teaching them, it's brainwashing them. The reaction time is slower. When you say sit, they kind of and they sit really slow. It's just, I don't know. I'm kind of experimenting right now. I'm kind of caught in limbo. I know what's right. I know what's wrong. But people seem to look at the dogs that I have and be like, you know, they're not responsive and they don't do well. But then I look at the compulsive trainers. Dogs' reaction times are similar, except the freaking tails between the legs. They're not walking happily, and they're scared. And they flinch when they say sit. They're like, oh crap, am I gonna get a leash correction? Watch it closely in their videos. This dog doesn't flinch. Oh. He's getting a little unsure now since I've been doing the place work. But shit, I would too if I got an electric shock if I moved. I am coming back into home trying to replenish his drive so not to kill his drive when we're doing other things like a heel, or down, or sit in motion, any of that type of stuff. But, you know, since he is a house dog and I do have to take him to adoption events, I guess I want him to place for 3 hours at a time without moving, which takes a lot of pressure on a dog, but it does. It's gonna kill his drive a little bit, but you know, gotta get him a home, man. He can't stay here forever. He's already been here for about 2 years. We've had him since he was a 7-month-old puppy. But he's gonna get distracted. He's gonna be like, people! He loves people, mainly because of my young son. When we first got him, he was such a rambunctious puppy. He was 7 months, and my son loved it. My son ran with him and got him all happy and excited and jumpy. And so, you know, he sees people, he's like, people, yes! But he sees another dog, he does the same thing. But if the dog bulks up or shows any signs of aggression, this dog won't back down. He won't bite back. He's not necessarily dog aggressive, he's very hyper, and a lot of dogs can't take it. Just play. So that's one of the hardest things with Diesel, is finding him just as handling without a dog. He's a beautiful butt. And he's very driven. He loves to play. I play with hoses, I play with drills. I play with hoses wrapped with you. Since we're not doing anything, I'm actually trying to put him on the sleeve. Since he's not going anywhere, you know, maybe start doing shots on routine with him. Just for shits and giggles, but I can't do much with him. He can't jump because he definitely is showing signs of dysplasia, man. Like, when we first got him, after 2 months, taking him to his first adoption event, I don't know, it's the damnedest thing. He started running and playing. He was excited to let him out first thing in the morning. Woo, you know I'm out. And then all of a sudden, you heard a pop. And he started running because he was scared and it hurt him. So he heard a pop, 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 pop. And I took him to the vet. And the vet's like, yep, it's definitely the joint rubbing on the bone, you know? So bone rubbing on the bone, not in the joint, like the cartilage like should be there. So he is definitely going to have some problems. And I'm not working him to the point, oh, look, made a mistake. I did kind of pull him back. Still not a correction, just leading him back. I necessarily don't like it. He's kind of confused, like I said. For a year and a half to 2 years, he's walking 45 feet in front of me. So this isn't really bad within 2 or 3 days. This is phenomenal. Especially with the same person that he was walking 45 feet in front of. Just that's walking by my side. And in the last video that I just talked into that I made yesterday, that was a few days after this, but as you can see, hardly any mistakes, and we're actually in front of the house, and he was doing great. He's healing. It's like, screw this loose leash, dude. If I have to walk by your side, I'm going to get something for it. Yeah, he's a great puppy. He's not bad at all. Working a little bit on the automatic sit here. Like, the first couple of days, I'm not going to show you. This other guy's going to come out, and he's really going to get distracted. It happens, you know. It's part of the learning process. I'm going to go over here because I'm so used to doing that and saying hi to these folks, and without a correction, it takes a little bit longer. They're compulsive trainers, although killing the dog spirits, who have this knockout. You would see automatic, instant improvement, but it's not instant improvement because you start correcting to the people, then the dog starts correlating the people and the pain. And as soon as it makes that correlation, either it becomes anxious around people, really scared of them. You either have a flight or fight type of situation a lot of the time. So, yeah. I either want to fight the people or fight the people. It brings pain to them. And there's no point of bringing unnecessary pain to a dog, I don't believe. And that's why I'm stuck with freaking limbo. You guys want a trained dog, but you want it now, and then you don't want the dog to fucking move. It's a dog, man. It's a dog. It's not a robot. It's not a lamp. It's not a piece of furniture. It's a dog. So let our dogs be dogs. Teach them. Teach them well. Spend time with them. When you come home, don't plop your ass in front of the TV and then expect to have a bond with your dog where you're like, hey, dude, get off the couch. You're bothering. If you don't spend time with your dogs aren't going to have mutual respect for you. They're going to be loyal to you. They're going to be happy to see you. But if you ask something of them, they're not going to do it. They're going to be like, who are you to tell me anything? You haven't taught me shit. So, people, best of luck. If you watched all 13 minutes of this video and you heard me curse, my apologies. Best of luck in training. If you need help, give us a call, 813-600-7000, www.ndwk9.com. We are motivational dog walkers, and like I said, best of luck. Have fun training. If you're not having fun, you're doing it wrong. Okay? If the dog's not having fun, you're doing it fucking wrong. Let's stop causing problems and aggression, people. Stop beating your dogs. Peace!